Welcome to Skytalkers. Here are your hosts, Charlotte and Caitlin.
Hello, and welcome to Skytalkers. I'm your host, Charlotte.
Hey, everyone. I'm your other host, Caitlin, and welcome to this week's episode where we are celebrating the 40th anniversary of Return of the Jedi with our own 40 things that we love about Return of the Jedi.
There's so many things. There's more than 40 things.
Yeah.
And yet, we made a list.
We did make a list. It's not going to be a list episode. I mean, the conceit is essentially a list episode, but we're not going to go like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5,
but
6.
Just trust there are 40 things, okay?
There are 40 things. but we thought it would be fun to kind of go through some of the things we love about Return of the Jedi. And I don't know, it's always fun to talk about one movie at a time, especially because it was just in theaters and it's the first time either of us have seen an original trilogy film in theaters. So it felt like we needed to kind of commemorate it somehow.
Yeah, it's actually so crazy if I reflect on it about how we have never seen before Return of the Jedi an original trilogy movie in theaters. Mm-hmm. It was so special to watch it, and I know that we'll get into it, but it really is an insane fact that it's taken us this long to get here. And it's not for lack of trying. Like, I think that if there were the option, we would have taken it, right?
But oh, yeah.
There was no option.
wasn't the only other option? Didn't they show the entire saga before one of the sequel trilogy films came out?
Yeah, that was we were never going to be able to do that.
No.
I know that there are definitely people who are listening who did that, but
yeah,
just
that
in terms
our
of
life.
Our mental state, it was just never going to happen.
Yeah.
As much as I would love to do that in isolation, like if that was something that they offered just on a random Thursday, I would totally do that. But before a new movie in which I have so much like anxiety and anticipation about, I was never going to spend like 12 hours in the movie theater for that. I have a lot of other things that I need to be panicking about.
We barely survive our sequel trilogy viewings because we would see them multiple times in one night. And I mean, we all know how The Last Jedi went after.
Exactly.
After we saw that, survived on a full day of like cheese sticks and popcorn, and it did not end well for us.
For Charlotte, particularly.
Specifically, so, Charlotte. I didn't want to. Yeah, Charlotte.
You can throw me under the bus there. Yeah, I was so anxious about it. It just would have never happened. So I think that this being Return of the Jedi coming back into theaters, and I understand there was a very limited amount of theaters that this movie was in. I think it was 500 theaters or something, which is not a lot. I feel very lucky that we were in, you know, a metropolitan area in which we could see that. But it is insane that it was our first one. And I know that if you're listening, you're like, that's crazy. But maybe some of you are also in the same boat as us. But yeah, maybe you want to start off the list, Caitlin, with some of your thoughts about what we love about Return of the Jedi and this experience in particular.
Yeah, so I wanted to start off kind of our conversation about Return of the Jedi in that I got to take my three oldest nieces to see Return of the Jedi in theaters with me. So that was really exciting. And I realized kind of belatedly that this is actually the first time I've watched Star Wars in a theater with family members, which is kind of wild. And if you're a longtime listener of Skytalkers, you know that my family is not, they're just not into Star Wars. It's not really their thing. So that was never a thing where we would go and see it as a family when the new movies came out. In fact, I would go with Charlotte's family to see them when the new movies came out. But a couple months ago, I started watching all of the Star Wars films with my three oldest nieces. And it's been such a treat. And it was really exciting to get to take them in theaters to see Return of the Jedi. And we're almost done with their full saga watch. It's been a very slow and steady pace for us. We actually just finished the prequel trilogy and have watched The Force Awakens. But it was so cute because I was telling them that we were going to go see Return of the Jedi, and they've been kind of excited to get to the sequel trilogy and Rey and everything like that. So they were a little bit like, oh, well, we already saw Return of the Jedi. And I was in the car and I was like, no, you don't understand. I was like, I have never seen this movie in theaters. The fact that you get to see this movie in theaters
at such a young age.
At such a young age is really, really important. And they were like, oh, okay.
And how lucky are they that they get to watch that in theaters and then go home and watch mm-hmm. The Force Awakens right away.
Yeah. It's just... yeah, it was pretty great. We did that one. We did the Return of the Jedi on a Sunday, and then the Force Awakens that following Friday or Saturday. So we just have The Last Jedi and The Rise of Skywalker left. And then I told them they can start any show that they want. And I think they're going to start The Mandalorian. That's what I think a lot of their friends at school talk about, is The Mandalorian. So they're kind of excited to start that after the saga is complete. But I was like, nope, we have to lay the foundation of the saga. But the first time they watched Return of the Jedi a couple months ago at their house, they really liked it. And they were totally in on Vader's redemption and totally picking up on his like emotional cues throughout the episode, throughout the film. And they become like really big Luke fans over the course of the original trilogy, which is great for me because I'm a big Luke fan. But it was great to have them watch it. And my youngest niece, Blakely, she's 6. She had kind of fallen asleep the first time we watched Return of the Jedi. So half of the movie was kind of her first time seeing it in theaters on some parts of it. But they had a great time. And it was super special to watch it with them. And I've never seen 3 little girls inhale popcorn at the rate that they inhaled popcorn throughout this movie. It was... I was like, we've got to slow down, girls. I got like the big popcorn. And anyway, they were like monsters, little monsters eating the popcorn all throughout Return of the Jedi. It was great. I don't mean to ramble. I've just really enjoyed the experience of watching Star Wars with them for the first time, and getting to take them to the theaters for Return of the Jedi was, you know, just top tier for me personally.
Yeah, I think that's really special.
Yeah.
So if I were to start off my list of things I love about Return of the Jedi, I'm going to start with something very personal, just like you did.
Tell me, what's the personal story for you?
Luke Skywalker's Chanel boots are so personal. It's just something that could be so personal. So Luke Skywalker's boots, I think that this has become a meme a little bit about his black outfit and these black boots that are just giving the most. I love these boots so much, and I love that they're called the Chanel boots, even though as a little bit of a fashion person that I am, if I can even claim that, I don't know if I can. They're not actually Chanel boots. I just need to share that. But I think for the sake of the universe, I think they can be Chanel boots, you know? So I think it's amazing that in Return of the Jedi, Luke returns in this like totally killer outfit that is all black, and the boots are just such a vibe.
You know what Luke is doing?
He's
dressing for revenge.
He is. You're so right. He's in his Reputation era.
He's in his Reputation era.
And I love it so much. And I just think that we need to start there with the Chanel boots. And like I said, it's very personal. So.
Yeah, very extremely personal. The Chanel boots. Yeah, I think that you and I both kind of had this in kind of multiple parts on our list, but just the music and hearing the opening fanfare, the crawl in the theater was just absolutely spectacular, I think. Although we'd be remiss to talk about Return of the Jedi without talking about the three dots at the end of the crawl, mm-hmm. which is also mm-hmm. personal, but rather than good personal, I'd say like a personal attack.
It is a personal attack.
Yeah.
The fact that there are 4 dots in every single crawl except for Return of the Jedi, in which there are 3, it has plagued me for most of my life.
I twitch.
It's an eye twitch for sure. It's really insane. I don't understand how someone let this happen, how this isn't something that has been changed during the special editions. How are we still here with the 3 dots? And also, like, how do I get to the point where I grow to love the 3 dots versus the fact that it doesn't match the rest of the saga with the 4 dots? I don't know.
It's like, even knowing that all of the fonts and like even color of the crawl is kind of different throughout the years doesn't bother me. Like, I think it should maybe bother me because it's not all consistent. But the 3 dots just really kind of sends me over the edge. And yeah. I think this would be a great time to once again push our crawl episode that we did like 3 years ago.
That no one listened to.
That no one listened to. It came out right before Thanksgiving. We can't blame the people, but we did an episode where we talked, where we analyzed and annotated all of the crawls of the Skywalker saga. So I'm sure we talked about the three dots in that episode too, and we're still equally disturbed.
Mm-hmm. I'm so disturbed, to be honest. Like, I know that we're talking in jest here, but like, it actually really bugs me that it's just three dots instead of four. And I think that at that point, like, we need to move on. But I think everyone needs to know that this has plagued us for so long. And I have to think that we aren't the only people.
No, no, we're absolutely not.
What's Return of the Jedi is an A plus movie, but it has a
B plus crawl.
And it's not even because of the text of the crawl, it's because of the ellipses. The fact that it went full ellipses versus the four dots, which isn't an ellipse, like, that really bugs me.
Okay, we have to move on from the B plus crawl. A plus movie, B plus crawl. We should put that on a t-shirt. I think one of the things that also gets me that's on my list is, I wouldn't say this is something I necessarily like about Return of the Jedi. I mean, I do, but the droid torture chamber in Jabba's palace, I always forget how dark it is. It's so dark. And the little gonk droid that's upside down and gets his feet branded, and he's like, oh, he's like so scared. It's so sad.
It really is so sad, but I have to say, something that kind of bugs me about that scene is that the branding never actually reaches the gunk droid's feet. It's like going on like a Disney ride and knowing that it's an animatronic over and over again, and that branding doesn't actually reach the feet.
Shouldn't that make you
happy?
Am
I crazy about that?
The gunk droids, yes, are your babies.
For sure, but I think they are my babies. You're right. But I think that it's just... it is something that like gets me every time. And maybe I'm totally wrong about that. I want someone to prove this to me, but I swear the brandishing doesn't hit the feet, in which
they decided that would be too dark. It would have made it PG-13.
So true. Before PG-13 was the thing. But yeah. I think we should linger in the Jabba's palace a little bit. So on my list there, I feel like in the movie theater, so just to go back to the place of Caitlin and I finally seeing Return of the Jedi in the movie theater, there were so many good things about seeing this in the theater. And one of them was how many of the weirdos you could see in Jabba's palace, in the shadows, behind the screen. Like, I don't know. I couldn't see it in what some might call like the full screen, widescreen of your DVD player when I was younger. And I feel like you could see so much more, and that was so great. I loved that. And it really reminded me of the Tom Spina Blast Points Amy Ratcliffe panel that happened in Celebration Anaheim, where they went through every single behind the scenes creature that was constructed at ILM for Return of the Jedi and how much work went into those, and how you can't really see like 90% of them, but honestly, in the theater, you could see some of them. And I could recognize that, and I thought that was really cool.
Yeah, I did too. I think the lighting, it's different on a giant movie theater screen. And I don't know, it feels like there's a million places to look at once, but almost like there's more time to look at everything that's going on screen.
Totally. And if we want to linger here in Jabba's palace, I have a couple of things on my list for this. I think Boba Fett touching that one lady's face or her chin or whatever is just such an iconic moment for Boba Fett's characterization, and how I would assume so many people characterized him as like a womanizer or like the best ever when that was basically all the Boba Fett content that you got. And when I see that in the movie theater, it was something that was so funny, was that people laughed and sort of like loved that little bit when he touches the chin of that one woman. And I don't know. I love that. I love that like miniature characterization of Boba Fett there.
Yeah, I think the humor and the like moments that you remember from Return of the Jedi are just so good. Return of the Jedi is my favorite original trilogy film. And I just think there's something about the pacing of it and the humor of it that just really kind of captures the audience. I think even throughout this whole beginning sequence with Jabba's palace and the sail barge and everything, it just continues to be some of my favorite Star Wars, no matter how many times I've seen it. I think our year of Jabba continues for you and I. I know we both had a couple comments on our list about Jabba. Famously, Charlotte and I have had a renaissance with Jabba the Hutt this year, the past 12 months, I don't even know. I wasn't going to mention it, but due in large part to our favorite Instagram account, Mighty Jabba's Collection. And we got a lot of Jabba merch at Celebration this year.
Is this the fifth time we've mentioned Mighty Jabba's Collection on the show? Feels like it. It's
getting up there.
It really is. And honestly, the Jabba the Hutt newfound love was on my list too.
Mm-hmm.
In addition to the newfound love of the Rancor,
yeah,
which I felt like is more in line with the Book of Boba Fett and how much I love the Rancor in the Book of Boba Fett. I think actually I thought about the Book of Boba Fett a lot when I was watching Return of the Jedi
Me
this
too.
Last time. And I loved that. I loved experiencing a Star Wars movie I've seen 100 times a little differently because of a television show. I love that. And I think the Rancor has always been a creature that I think the scene with the Rancor versus Luke has always been exciting and great. And obviously you're rooting for Luke, but I think that scene at the end with the Keeper has always really hit hard, no matter what. And it hit a little different this time coming from Book of Boba Fett. And I really enjoyed that. And I think that I just really have this newfound love for Jabba's Palace, this whole scene, which I'm a little ashamed to admit that I used to think is like a slog. I used to think of as like a slog to get to the real meat of Return of the Jedi, which I think is the redemption aspect, and like the parts with Luke and Vader, which always used to be like my bread and butter for why I loved Return of the Jedi. But I love the Jabba's Palace stuff nowadays. And I think it's because of, like you mentioned, that Instagram account, but also just, I don't know, learning more about what went into this entire part of the movie.
Yeah, you know, I think I've always loved the beginning section of Return of the Jedi with Jabba, but it was never because of Jabba himself or anyone around him. It was always because of what was going on with Luke, Leia, and Han, and Lando, and Chewie, and the kind of antics that they were getting into. I know one of my favorite moments is when Luke and Han are on the barge, you know, going to the Sarlacc pit, and you know, Han is like, oh, I think I can see something. And Luke quips, there's nothing to see. I used to live here, you know. And Han goes, you're going to die here, you know. Convenient. I don't know.
It's perfect.
It's such a good line. I love their delivery of it. I know that Harrison Ford has made a lot about thinking that Han should have died in Empire Strikes Back and how he's kind of made into this comedy role a lot in Return of the Jedi, but he does it so well. And the way that he delivers these lines is just so good. And you can really see the difference between Luke and Han in these moments. And one of my all-time favorite moments from Luke is when R2 throws him the lightsaber and he does the whole like flippity flip off of the plank, and you know, just absolutely iconic. But yeah, I'm with you though. Kind of sorry to backtrack, but on Boba Fett, I feel like I thought about him a lot. This isn't the first time I've watched Return of the Jedi since the Book of Boba Fett, but I don't know. I was definitely thinking about him a lot when watching it in theaters, and especially when he falls into the Sarlacc pit, and thinking about his exodus from the Sarlacc pit was kind of my immediate next thought, which was kind of cool knowing that his story continues and that he does have all of this like character development in the Book of Boba Fett, and how much I love Temuera Morrison, and I hope we get more of him back in Star Wars because he's just so good in the role. And yeah, the other thing I kept thinking about from Book of Boba Fett was the Hutt twins. We're the Hutt twins, and hope they're doing okay. Hope they're doing all right. I want to see them again.
Me too. I love them so much, and they were really such a highlight of the Book of Boba Fett. I will never forget the first time we laid eyes on them. It was love at first sight.
This was even before our Jabba Renaissance. And they slid onto the screen and my life was never the same. I was like,
they appeared as like an oasis out in the screen, and then they came forth, and they were real. They were real to us.
So real.
I was like, so great.
Anyway, I really want to see them again. I want to hear what antics they're getting up to and how they are, you know, what new places they're being carried to across the galaxy.
Me too. This is why we need a season 2 of Book of Boba Fett, yes. Because it has to fully revolve around the twins so that we just get them more, because it's just such a perfect character design. I'm so obsessed with this. More Hutts, please. Like, I'm obsessed. On the opposite end, as much as I love Jabba the Hutt now, I also hate Jabba the Hutt. And I think when Leia slays Jabba the Hutt, it is such a good moment. And experiencing that in the theater and hearing the audience cheer when Leia does choke Jabba is really invigorating and felt really good. I don't know what your theater was like, Caitlin, but my theater was like packed full and people were shouting, cheering, clapping, and they really did cheer for Leia slaying Jabba the Hutt here. And I cheered along right with them. I thought it was great. And I think there's something, just to comment on that, when you're in a theater with people who have seen the movie before or never have, and are so reactionary. I've seen Return of the Jedi like 100 times on Disney Plus or on my DVD player or something, and it really is special. I've basically seen it with like maybe 4 people max in a living room, right? And I think that when you expand that number and you see you're in a room with people who actually enjoy it just as much as you do, or just on some level of enjoying it more than like your average person, you really get an amazing response. And that was really special to hear that. It even like made me tear up a little bit, and just like the power of the moment of Leia slaying her captor. I think it is just so great. And I know that Caitlin and I have spent a lot of time talking about Leia as a character on our Essays on Carrie series. I don't know if people have checked that out. It's a series that Caitlin and I do on academic essays about Carrie Fisher and Leia that are about feminism and understanding the character of Leia through different lenses. And I think as I get older, I appreciate different iterations of the character of Leia. And this really hit me, I guess, in the theater watching this scene.
Yeah, I think especially because this kind of reinterpretation of Leia as the Hutt Slayer is relatively recent in the timeline of Star Wars. And so to have a theater that's reacting to that moment specifically, kind of in support of that Hutt Slayer persona for Leia, I think is really cool to see how fandom has kind of embraced that interpretation of Hutt Slayer kind of superseding slave Leia.
Totally. And as I get older, I think obviously I prefer the Hutt Slayer terminology, but I can't forget about the fact that for like 30 plus years, like that iteration of Leia was referred to as slave Leia. And sometimes I like wrestle with that a little bit in my mind. And I don't know if that makes sense, but it makes more sense if we talk about it on our Essays on Carrie episode. So if you haven't checked those out, this is a plug for that. Just to stay on the topic of Leia a little bit, I found myself really struck by something that I had never noticed before this last time I watched Return of the Jedi. And there was a lot of revelations, but this one for me was the biggest revelation. And it was how much I love the Leia as Boosh, the bounty hunter who's masked, part in the movie. I think that I've loved this scene forever. But what really struck me is that Leia as Boosh takes off her helmet to Han Solo. Han Solo is blind. He is unable to see, and in a lot of ways, like incapacitated. And Leia removes her helmet and reveals herself as someone who loves you. And what really struck me in this instance was how this scene with Leia and Han actually mirrors the Vader and Luke scene at the end of the movie. Mm-hmm. And how when, and I just had never thought about this, and I just think it's really brilliant. Because when Leia reveals herself, the first thing she says is, this is someone who loves you. And so I think in the first act of Return of the Jedi, we're instilled in this thought that, you know, a Skywalker, as we learn Leia is, who takes off her helmet, is unmasked, is someone who is loving. We get that with Vader and Luke later when Vader sacrifices himself to save his son, but then also wants his helmet to be removed in front of his son just so that he can lay his eyes on him for the first time in his entire life. And I think the whole scene, I don't know, like, it's just really emotional to me because I think it's very clear. It's not like Vader says, or Anakin, I guess you can say, Anakin says to Luke, like, oh, I love you, son, right? Like, that's not something that is said, but we start the movie with Leia taking off her helmet, revealing herself as something else to someone who doesn't know who she is, and says, I am someone who loves you. And then we get basically the same thing that happens with Vader with his son removing his helmet, and Vader, Anakin, you know, saying like, your sister was right. It's just all these things. I feel like it was so reflective and really underscores the fact that Anakin sacrificed himself for love for his son. And that both of these people who are mass are someone who loves the other person. And I just, like, it really blew me away in that moment. I don't know.
Yeah, I don't think I'd ever really thought about the parallel between Leia and Vader with the unmasking. It's such, like, a great bookend to both the beginning of the film and the end of the film. And if you wanted to take the meta a little bit further too, then we could start talking about how, you know, most people kind of associate Leia's personality and tendencies with Anakin rather than Padme, for example. I can't think of the Obi-Wan quote right now, and I hate that about myself, but that great quote from Obi-Wan in the show to little Princess Leia about, like, her passionate father or something like that. That's very much Leia, and her tendencies are a lot like Anakin in a lot of ways. I think that's such a great parallel that I also hadn't really thought about.
It's one of those things that, like, it blew me away in that I had never considered it as someone who has watched Return of the Jedi as much as I have and have always looked for those kind of parallels. And it's one of those things that, like, when it like strikes you when you're in the movie theater surrounded by this, like, insane sound, like, it really, like, overcomes you.
Yeah.
And you're like, oh, wow. This is one of those movies that's, like, so brilliantly written. No wonder it's, like, a classic. And I can't believe I've never noticed that before.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, totally, totally. I will say one of the other little pieces of foreshadowing that I was thinking a lot about in this viewing was in this beginning chunk of the film when Luke gets his hand shot, his mechanical hand, and how this is in a lot of ways really good foreshadowing to what's going to come with his duel with Vader, and the emphasis on the hand. And I know, of course, we've talked a lot about hands. Hands are a language, after all, and kind of this parallel between Luke losing his hand and Anakin losing his hand. But I think specifically this moment in Return of the Jedi of Luke's injured mechanical hand, and then this kind of being something that is heavily emphasized and part of Luke's kind of realization about what he's doing, the path that he could be on when he looks at, or when he chops off Vader's hand and sees all of the wiring and stuff like that. Mm. And I don't know. I thought it was a good little moment of foreshadowing that I don't know if we've necessarily talked about that moment specifically, but in our greater conversation of hands are a language. But yeah, it was something I thought about. And yeah.
I think it's interesting that you say that's a moment of foreshadowing, because I would actually say that's backshadowing. Because I've always thought that that moment was Luke realizing how similar him and Vader are. And, like, I know that's what you're getting at, in that it is, like, a foreshadowing of, like, his dark path of, like, turning more machine now than man. But I always felt like when I saw that, at least my sort of in the past, like, 5 years of us having this podcast and things like that and talking through things deeply about, like, redemption, what it means, I have always thought that moment was a moment of Luke realizing, oh my gosh, we're similar, versus, oh my gosh, we're similar and that is bad. It's more like, oh my gosh, we're similar and, like, that is a man and we have made the same mistakes.
Yes and no. I agree with you that, yeah, I think the moment is Luke saying we're similar, but I also think there's a shade of this, like, that could be me. Like, the whole point is now Palpatine yes. wants Luke to take Vader's place. He doesn't necessarily say that, but I think we all know that's what Palpatine would eventually have wanted Luke to do, was to take Vader's place. So I don't know. I think, yes, I agree with you that it is that we're similar, but I also think it's both sides of that. We're similar. We're both human, but then also I could go down this path just as easily too. And almost like a look what's happened to him, the same as me in some instances too. And I think that the emphasis, like the fact that they added that shot in the beginning of the film of Luke injuring his mechanical hand, only to then have the focus be on the mechanical hands at the end as well, is intentional. And I don't know if I've ever really thought about there being two scenes effectively about the mechanical hands mm-hmm. in Return of the Jedi at opposite ends of the film.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think that to that note, something that I think about a lot actually is the deleted scene of Luke igniting his lightsaber, that just to kind of move on a little bit. At Caitlin and I's first Star Wars celebration in 2010, they announced, I think on the last day, that they were going to be coming out with the Blu-ray disc that we all know, the 9-disc set of the 6 Skywalker saga movies before the sequels, that came with 9 discs, with 3 of them being bonus features. And they announced and showed us for the first time this deleted scene of Luke constructing his lightsaber before he goes into Jabba's palace. And I think about this all the time because I think it's so crazy that we saw that for the first time together. Although, do you remember that when that was shown?
It was like, oh my God, there's something new to see.
Exactly. It was so crazy. And I think so highly of that Blu-ray disc and how special it was to buy it, because I literally bought a Blu-ray player so I could watch these bonus features. But the fact that there was something separate, and then it just made me think about how I think it's so brilliant that Luke's entrance into Jabba's palace is when it is versus when he's constructing this lightsaber. I think the green lightsaber reveal of his like new lightsaber, I think it's good that it happens off screen, but seeing this first, if you haven't seen it, please Google it, of Luke outside of Jabba's palace in a cave, basically constructing and like putting together this lightsaber and igniting it for the first time. And I think that would have been cool and it would have been fine. I don't think we would have thought much about it if that was the first introduction that we saw of Luke. But I think it really is powerful to see the first introduction of Luke in Return of the Jedi being this like Jedi that you don't really know where he stands. It's been 3 years since Empire Strikes Back. This is just me imagining what it would be like to see Return of the Jedi in the movie theater, right? But I would imagine there's so much theorizing that goes into, where is Luke? Where is Luke's mental state after he finds out that Vader's his father? Is he actually his father? What's he going to do? He left Yoda's training. He could turn to the dark side. He could be like on his own path. And I think the reveal of him in Jabba's palace, like, yeah, he's a Jedi Knight, sure. And that's what we hear about. But he does look darker. Like, he has this, like I mentioned, the Chanel boots, but like this like whole new fit that's all black, that's all different. And I think it's really powerful to have the entrance that we get. But I do think it was so crazy to watch that deleted scene for the first time with a bunch of fans in the theater in the convention center when we saw that in 2010. And it really is so insane that was a deleted scene that no one had seen for so long.
Yeah, I think that scene would have been, it kind of would have added to the ominousness of Luke going into Jabba's palace, because it is like that dark cave kind of vibe. And it's like, ooh, this bright green lightsaber in the middle of this dark cave. Like, what is going on? I can't even remember if you can see Luke's face super clearly in that scene either. So I wonder if you could have even thought, oh, is this someone different? It's been a minute since I've watched the scene, honestly. So it could be very obvious that it's Luke. But I think ultimately you're right that it's good, this spot where we kind of had this reveal of Luke and his lightsaber. But it's interesting to think about what we would have thought about Luke if that had been our first shot of him.
Yeah, I don't know. I think that there's been so much conversation in the past 5 years, 10 years about The Last Jedi and Luke as he gets older and how we perceive Luke Skywalker as a character. Everything that we saw in the sequel trilogy is not necessarily like super surprising to me and never has been, unlike some people who watch that. And I think that's totally okay too, if like that is your perception that you were super surprised by that. But I feel like it might have, maybe it would have been good to see this side of Luke at a little bit earlier. I don't know. Who knows?
I think this whole viewing, actually Return of the Jedi, really made me kind of think how everything that we see from Luke in The Last Jedi kind of starts to make a lot more
sense.
Sense isn't the right word, because I've always bought into Luke's trajectory in a character arc. So I think, and that's coming from someone who was, if you go back and listen to our initial Last Jedi reaction, you'll hear that I was very kind of shocked and a little bit like, I don't know what to do with this version of Luke upon first watch.
Yeah. And I think it should be noted that maybe if this is your first time listening to Skytalkers, like Caitlin's favorite character before Kylo Ren, I guess, was Luke Skywalker. Mm-hmm. So it's an interesting place to always be in when your favorite character is Luke Skywalker and then your other favorite character is Kylo Ren.
Yeah.
So something to just keep in mind.
Yeah. And I think you could definitely hear that kind of conflict in our initial Last Jedi reaction. But of course, I became a huge Last Jedi fan, and it's definitely probably my favorite Star Wars movie. Definitely my favorite of the sequel trilogy. But I guess if we're going to move into some of our Luke commentary here, I think I was really kind of struck in this viewing of how I can see the version of Luke that removes himself from the story and goes to Octo in isolation. And one of the big things, this is really jumping ahead, but I was just thinking a lot about how Luke doesn't tell anyone that Vader is his father in this like entire 3 years, and that he's kept this secret and this burden to himself for this long. And I literally have no idea if I've ever really thought super deeply about this before. I don't know, but it kind of hit me again, like the first time, I guess, in this viewing. And I was like, you know, this detail alone could have really pushed forward the narrative that we will see on Bloodline of Leia not telling anyone, of them not telling Kylo, of it coming to bite them later down the line with Ben Solo, and then Luke feeling the burden and guilt of that he does and his choices with Kylo to then leave and seclude himself, isolate himself on Octo. And I don't know, I think there's kind of, to your point about how Luke is presented in the beginning of this film, is like he's got a new fit, it's a little darker, like who is this, what's he been doing for 3 years? And what he's been doing for 3 years is ruminating on Vader as his father to no one else, just him. And I think that's really important to think about with his character, and I really don't know if I've ever kind of internalized that when I've been thinking about Luke's characterization, especially for that length of time, right? For 3 years, that's a really long time given everything else that's going on in the galaxy. He hasn't told Leia. I don't know if R2-D2 knows, like, who is there in Luke's life that he can talk to about this? And I think this is a really interesting facet of his character that he chooses to keep this to himself. And yeah, it kind of, like I said, it kind of clicked into place some things about Luke going to Octo later on in the sequel trilogy era. And yeah, I don't know. What did you think about that?
Yeah, I think that's so true. And I haven't thought too much about that, but I think it's really something that we should think a little bit. And I'm glad that we're talking about it now. That there's a lot, you know. Sorry, let me just backtrack. I think it's really good that we're talking about this right now, because I actually do think that maybe you're forgetting that we have talked about this before, Caitlin, in our concealment episode, about how something that is so crucially a problem with the Skywalkers is that they don't talk about anything, and how everything would be better if they'd actually communicated a little bit clearer. And this is one of those occurrences. I think even the conversations about how Luke talks to Leia about how they're siblings, Luke leaves a lot on the table. and also like conceals a lot before leaving. And I think it fills Leia with a lot of anguish and anxiety to the point where she like doesn't know how to talk to her, you know, I guess for lack of a better term, like boyfriend, lover, Han Solo about, right? I think a lot about how the do you remember your mother conversation, to be honest, not to shift gears completely, but I do think it's in the same realm of conversation about mm-hmm. how things aren't really talked about. They're sort of like talked around. And I think this is a whole thing in Star Wars in a lot of ways, not just like intertextually when we talk about the Skywalkers and their issues, but I do think that Star Wars thrives a lot on vagueness. And I think about the do you remember your mother conversation, and every time I watch it, I suspend my disbelief even more, if I'm being honest. It doesn't bother me in the slightest, which I think
maybe not like the three dots.
No, that bothers me to my core. This doesn't bother me that much. And maybe it should bother me a little bit, but I think I can sort of rationalize some of it of like Leia remembering feelings. And I think that her feelings are potentially the Force and like, that's fine. But that conversation, I think, is a lot. We think about that conversation in the context of the original trilogy as like a very revelatory conversation, but like it's really not. They don't talk about a lot, right? Like they just say, oh, by the way, you have the Force, you are my sibling, and like, oh, you recognize that, like, you know, it's not, this isn't weird, this is how it's always gonna be, but by the way, I have to go kill her father. And Leia's like, you don't have to go do that. It's okay. And then he leaves.
Leave,
you know, and
place.
That's it. Yeah. And I think that like they don't talk about anything, and then they don't talk about it again. And like that's it. So it's sort of
it's just
they don't talk about anything is the point. And I think it's interesting, and what happens is the audience is left to their imaginations, which is good and bad. Again, like I said, that conversation bothers me less and less as I get older. But when I do think about the context of, like you said, if we want to put that in perspective of the Luke Skywalker who does run away from his problems in The Last Jedi and removes himself from the situation because he thinks that's the smartest thing to do. Of course he does, because he doesn't actually talk about it until he sees Leia and Force projects himself across the galaxy in order to have the important conversation. And like, thank God he did, because after that he dies. But like, if he didn't have that conversation, right? He needed to have that conversation, you know? And yeah, that's it. I have a lot of deep thoughts about it.
Well, and continuing our deep kind of Luke thoughts, let's return to one of our other faves, Yoda. I think we both have been thinking a lot about Yoda in Return of the Jedi and kind of his last scenes with Luke. And,
yeah,
you know, I was kind of struck this viewing of like, did he just decide that it was time to join the Force?
Right.
Now,
and I have so many questions.
calm down. And I don't know, the way that he kind of even still hesitates to admit the truth to Luke is still something so interesting. Charlotte and I, you know, before our new love of Jabba, we had a reckoning with the character of Yoda in our summer series just called Yoda. There wasn't a fun name to it. It was just called Yoda. But we talked a lot about our relationship with Yoda and his characterization within the film, and then also his characterization and kind of his what's the right word here? His reputation with the audience, I guess. Like, Yoda kind of lives these two lives, both within the film and with the audience in a lot of ways. And we kind of broke down our own feelings and analysis of all of that in our Yoda summer series, which I think was 2019, 2018, something like that. But I think in this viewing, I was struck once again of this, like, why can't he just tell Luke the truth of what happened? Why does he have to die right now?
Yeah. So I have been waiting to talk about this because I have a lot of thoughts, and they are written as follows. Did he wait to die until he saw Luke again? In which case, like, if he waited to die to be with Luke, that's just mean. But also, he barely was willing to like admit the truth as like the last living person who would know the truth for Luke. He like barely wanted to say it. And like, if you nodded off a little bit in the scene in Return of the Jedi, you would miss a lot. You know what I mean? Like, if you think about it. Okay. Second, when did he accept he was going to die? Why then? Why now? Why did Luke have to witness that? And why was that important to the story? Listen, like Caitlin mentioned, we've had a reckoning with Yoda. I actually love the character of Yoda a lot now. I didn't used to, and now I do. And his scenes are amazing. But this whole thing is so perplexing. Where Luke comes back, he's like, I'm going to finish my training. I'm so sorry, Yoda. And Yoda's like, nope, gotta peace go. Out. Time to die. And I think that's like traumatic. Like, poor Luke has dealt with so much trauma. And he's like, yo, can you tell me is Darth Vader my father? Like, I am struggling here. and he's like, yep, your father is. And then, you know, he's like, no, there's another Skywalker, and then dies. I mean,
he just says there's another.
Yeah. No, he says there's another Skywalker. And bye. Again, if you nod off in this moment, you miss a lot. And to the point where Luke has to be like, Ben, what? Ghost. What is happening? What am I? And I feel for Luke. That's the point. Because I feel like this is interesting. And I think just in the context of knowing Yoda, understanding the netherworld of the Force and like the different, you know, passage points and how to transform into a shadowy blue ghost and things like that. And we've seen all that in the Clone Wars, right? So you see this scene with new eyes as like he is welcoming death. But at the same time, it's sort of an inopportune moment when Luke really needs some answers. And I just feel bad for him.
Yeah, I do too. I mean, you do think it's been 3 years since Luke has been back on Dagobah. And again, he's kind of keeping all of this to himself and kind of wrestling with if this is the truth, if it's a lie. And he finally makes it back to Dagobah to talk to Yoda about this. And Yoda becomes one with the Force. Super inconvenient.
Super, super inconvenient.
So inconvenient. Yeah, that was definitely one of my kind of big thoughts. I like how you phrased it of if you nod off, you're going to miss some important bits and bobs in there.
It's like if you're not hanging on his every single word like Luke was, if you are not taking the place of the Luke character at this moment, then you are going to miss some serious important stuff. And I think about that a lot. So
I think, you know, even in our conversation just a minute ago about Luke and him and his character arc to who we see in The Last Jedi, you know, it feels like Yoda kind of removes himself from the story when he becomes one with the Force. And we kind of see Luke do a similar thing when he goes to Octo. And how could he not if this is, he kind of sees Yoda make this decision as well when the proverbial shit hits the fan and Luke decides to do the same thing ultimately. And then, you know, to have it in The Last Jedi be Yoda that kind of talks some sense into Luke as a Force ghost, I think is also kind of a nice full circle poetry at rhymes, yada, yada, yada kind of moment.
Best scene. Best scene ever.
Yeah. I don't think we've really touched on just how good the speeder bike chase scene is on the big screen. Continues to be iconic. Luke Leia moments in this film never
so good.
Disappoint. And you kind of already talked about the moment with Leia and Luke at the end, you know, with the whole father-sister reveal. But one thing I do love about Return of the Jedi is how it kind of continues these moments of Leia being able to read Luke's feelings and sensing how he's feeling. And to your point earlier about Leia's feelings being the Force, I think they do a good job of kind of zeroing in on those moments. Like when he joins them, you know, before they go to Endor. And then when she sees him go out onto the little Boardwalk, Skywalk, whatever it's called, in the Ewok village, and she goes after him. She just has like a, she's in tune with her twin brother. And of course, we saw that kind of at the end of Empire Strikes Back for the first time. And I like how they continue these little moments of this in Return of the Jedi.
I do too. I can't get enough of like the twin moments in Return of the Jedi, which is funny because I don't love them in the sequel trilogy. I like the moment where Luke and Leia finally talk to each other in The Last Jedi, but everything else I'm not a huge fan of.
What else is there? And
the end of Rise of Skywalker and
oh,
like
the
a
training.
Bunch of stuff.
The training. Okay.
You know what? I don't mind the training if I'm being honest, but I don't know. Maybe I should take that back. I don't know if I really stand by that. Just whatever. I don't love the end of Rise of Skywalker. So like, that's it. That said, I do love the twin moments. And something I really wanted in the sequel trilogy actually was more acknowledgement of the fact that these two are siblings. And I'm really glad that we did get that through a lot of different ways. But some of my favorite moments in Return of the Jedi are the fact that Luke and Leia have like matching cute little outfits on Endor.
Fun.
I love the matching ponchos. I think that is so cute. I love that. I love when Luke says, you know, when Han is like, you were supposed to watch her. Where is Leia? And Luke's like, we got separated. And I love that because it's so meta. Because like they did get separated at birth. Like I love that. They were babies. And like sort of on the same topic, you know, we use the Luke and Leia theme in our podcast in a lot of ways in the beginning of it. If we have a 3-part episode when we talk about like our prologue. But the Luke and Leia theme is so rarely used. And I have always loved it. And I think it's a beautiful theme that reflects the Force theme and also brings in Leia's theme. And I just have always loved it. I think it's really sad and beautiful at the same time. And it's only really ever plays here and in The Last Jedi. So God bless. I remember, don't you remember when we were waiting for The Last Jedi to start in a movie theater and they played some like preview before The Last Jedi started and they used the Luke and Leia theme. And throughout the entire like prologue of waiting for The Last Jedi to come out, and Carrie at this point had already died. And it was sort of like if Mark Hamill and Carrie Fisher don't get a scene together in this movie, this is sort of like the last chance for that to happen. So hopefully Rian Johnson pulled through. And it was like, well, we don't know if he did. And then this preview played the Luke and Leia theme and you never hear it. And the point is you never hear it. And I think they had recognized, like they had called out that it was like on the soundtrack for The Last Jedi. And I was like, oh my God, Caitlin, I can rest easy. Something is going to happen in this movie in which the Luke and Leia theme has to be played, which means that they're going to be together. So that was so good.
Well, what I remember from that moment is you just breaking down sobbing as soon as I think it was a feature and they showed John Williams conducting the orchestra for Luke and Leia's theme. It was some AMC special or something like that. And you were just in the seat next to me eating popcorn and just sobbing.
Like, it was like, it's happening.
It hasn't even started yet.
Exactly.
Speaking of the Ewok village and kind of everything happening there, I think you and I both really enjoy C-3PO telling the story of the original trilogy. And I love all the Ewoks kind of listening. The ones right on Han's leg as Leia is also kind of cuddling him is super cute. I think there's a couple like outside trying to peer into the windows and 3PO sound effects. It's just such a cozy scene. And I don't know. I love the power of stories bringing people together.
Yeah, I have loved this for so long. And I think that on like a meta level, I think that 3PO telling the story of the original trilogy to the rest of the Ewok village really reinforces how 3PO and R2-D2 are like the framing narrative of the original trilogy and maybe the whole Skywalker saga, at least the prequels in the original trilogy. We start the original trilogy, we start Star Wars with these two, and the fact that they've been there through it all, and 3PO telling the story, and like you said, like the power of storytelling, I think that's so important. And I love that there's this like quiet moment here that even Leia perceives as like romantic, because it is romantic, because storytelling is romantic. And I've always loved that. Mm-hmm. I don't know. I think that 3PO can be like, especially in Return of the Jedi, like a gag scene, right? Of like, yeah, you know, he's the golden god and things like that. And I love that. I really do. But then he turns around and is like the storyteller that can captivate a whole audience. And then it signals to the audience that like, no, like we're following these heroes that are known throughout the galaxy, and this is their like epic story, and we're following an epic, and 3PO is here to orate it. And I think that's really cool.
I love the idea that 3PO has this kind of sound bank in his droid brain with the sound effects.
Totally.
Like, does he record those? Does he download them from somewhere? Is that like a LimeWire situation? I don't know.
Not the LimeWire.
Yeah. Music on demand. Pew, 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 pew. Well, kind of moving towards the end of the film, you and I have talked about this scene a lot in the past, I would say, 2 years. It's become one of our favorite scenes from Return of the Jedi, and it's the scene where Luke and Vader are talking after Luke turns himself in, and I think this has become a personal favorite. It didn't used to be when I was younger, but it has become a personal favorite in all of Star Wars, and especially in Return of the Jedi, of Luke and Vader's conversation. One thing I love about this scene is that it actually takes place outside. And again, it's kind of this nice parallel in a little bit to Luke and Leia's conversation just a few scenes earlier, you know, outside with all of the Endor trees around them. And now Luke and Vader are outside looking out onto the trees. And it's kind of like this no man's land a little bit before Luke is taken away to the Emperor. And I don't know, there's something about this scene. It's so good. And when my nieces watched it for the first time, actually, the two that were awake in this scene, they were both so sad in this scene. And all they said afterwards was, oh, Vader still loves his son. And I don't know, I think to me that was just a great succinct way of how this scene is so effective for these two characters, and how, you know, Vader is doing so much with the mask and his body language, and there's just such sorrow in the "it's too late for me, son." And the Obi-Wan show kind of kicks the emotion up a couple of notches with that line, I think, for me.
Yeah, I completely agree. I think this conversation is one of those that I can't believe was written in 1983 without mm-hmm. the prequels in mind, because you watch it and it fits so well. Unlike the "do you remember your mother" stuff, which like doesn't really fit, but I like suspend my disbelief. But this, there's no disbelief to be suspended. This is existing in the world in which I have so much context for. The thing that I think is so powerful about the scene, and I love that you zeroed in on the environments of it all, because I think that's so important to recognize, is the fact that it's outside and that it is no man's land. Because I think as an audience member, it's subliminally telling us that there's like somewhere to run, right? That there's like a mm-hmm. wildness versus a the confinement that you get when you're on the Death Star, you know, basically trapped viewing the battles that are happening around us. Like, this is completely separate. This is before Vader surrenders Luke to the Emperor. This is when he doesn't actually have to do that. There's actually somewhere to go, you know? And we've seen it. We've seen that wild, right? With the Ewoks, with the Ewok village. I think that's so true. But I find this conversation just so reminiscent of things of the past. But you don't even have to see the prequels to understand how effective this scene is, because there's so many pauses too that allow the audience to have a sense of imagination between what Vader is thinking about, what Luke is thinking about, what the next move is going to be. It's so good. And to that, I want to also talk about how later, when the battle between Luke and Vader is happening with the Emperor overseeing, after all that happens, I think something I wanted to call out in our list is the shot of Luke dragging his father's body through the corridor. And for the first time in a long time, I've thought about how I really wondered if Anakin actually was dying or if he could be saved, and how in a world of Star Wars in which I've seen people's bodies that have been blasted get like completely rewired and like robotic and everything like that. And I know that Vader is already there, so I think that's a little different, but I still think that he probably could have been saved. But at this point, like, it doesn't matter. All he really wanted out of his life at this point, like, he sacrificed himself. Like, the sacrifice was enough. He wants to see his son's face for the first time with his own eyes, without his mask on, without anything being between them. And just the shot, to me, I just think it's so devastating. And when you see it in the movie theater, you get the sense too of Luke dragging his body when everyone else is running to someplace else, some escape pod, figuring out some way off. And Luke is dragging this like robotic body through crumbling remains. And he's willing to do that. And he's actually willing to do more than that, right? Like, I think Luke is willing to put him on the ship, to take him to wherever he needs to go. But that's not really what Anakin wants. So I don't know. I think about that a lot now after that.
Yeah, I think one of the things I think about with that scene particularly is how no one else cares what's going on on the ship. You were talking about all the people running around behind them and how they all know who Vader is. They probably know who Luke is too, or at least some of them do. And none of them care about what's going on, or that their leader, because I guess Vader would be the next leader of the Empire, is, you know, missing in action or being drugged through the ship with his helmet off. It's kind of like, oh man, like all of that was for nothing, and all of this quote unquote prestige or power that Vader had accumulated during his time in the Empire was worth nothing because none of them came to save him in the end, which is, you know, that's the Empire. Of course they didn't, but to see that Luke, you know, is going through all that effort is really meaningful as his son.
So I think that we've like gotten to the end of the movie, which is just normal for us to like jump to the end and overanalyze everything. But I think in our, Caitlin and I each made a list, as you can probably tell, and we skipped over some of them for the sake of the conversation. So I think we have some stragglers that we want to get through to set, to make sure that we hit 40 things that we love about Return of the Jedi. So Caitlin, do you want to go first in your stragglers and then I can go?
Yeah, my stragglers are, I think your stragglers are more fun, but I have just three. One of them being the detail in Jabba's palace when, you know, Leia has rescued Han from the carbonite and they've both been caught by Jabba and the rest of his croons. And, you know, Han is trying to plead their case and Leia has to kind of move him around so that he's actually facing Jabba when he's talking.
Yes, I love that. I love all the small details that remind us that Han is actually blind.
Yeah, it's just a good moment. Then another one that I should have mentioned when we were just talking about, you know, Vader and Luke is that moment outside, that scene before Luke gets taken up to the Death Star, is the pause after Luke gets taken away, where we pause with Vader walking to the railing and putting his hand on the railing and kind of like a kind of moment. I think it's so important, so good. And then another one is when Luke, there's that a particular expression on Luke's face when he's being hunted by Vader during their duel where he looks so scared.
It's when Vader is taunting him about Leia.
Yeah, it is. And it's just such a particular expression that I don't think we see on Luke in any other scene throughout all of Star Wars. And I oddly remember this scene being used so much in fan vid edits on YouTube circa 2008-ish time frame. I just felt like they really overutilized this scene. It's kind of burned in my brain. So yeah, that was kind of a weird straggler to end on, but that was my last straggler.
I think that scene is, or that shot is particularly shot super well in the fact that Luke is in the foreground and the lighting on him is very blue and black. And in the background, I can't remember specifically because I don't have it in front of me, but I remember he's like off center. It's not a center shot.
Yeah. The light kind of just cuts across him.
It's just really crafted super well. Mm-hmm. And it's something, I'm not saying Star Wars isn't crafted in the same like beautiful way that it was back then, but it is just a really beautiful shot with lighting. And the lighting in the original trilogy is something I've paid very close attention to in recent years. And this is a really good scene that highlights how beautifully shot light on someone's face is, right? Mm-hmm. All right. So my stragglers kind of go back to right after the Jabba's barge situation and everyone is reconvening on the rendezvous point. I love how Han volunteers for the mission and doesn't tell Leia about it. But then afterwards, Leia's impressed and is like, count me in, General. And I love it. It's so just good. So heartwarming.
And I'm in too. Luke appears. Yes. It's so great.
It's so good.
The gang's all here.
I don't mean to do this, but I'm going to.
Oh, okay.
So I think Star Wars does something super well in that it recognizes its gang, okay? The original trilogy in particular. It's trio, okay? It nailed it. Because I think I remember something so specifically, and it was like I was young and I had just seen Pirates of the Caribbean Dead Men's Chest, which is the second Pirates of the Caribbean, okay? And my dad was like, and it's just so funny how you remember like specific comments. My dad was like, you know, I liked the movie. It was really long, but I felt like in Pirates of the Caribbean, they were all friends. And in this one, I didn't feel like they were all friends. Mm-hmm. And it made me kind of sad. And I remember being like, that's true, actually. Like, I think that obviously Pirates set up a lot of different dynamics between the three main characters in that movie. And I'm obviously not here to talk about Pirates, but I think that comment is really interesting because I think Star Wars does respect the fact that, yeah, we think they're all friends and it's nice that they're all friends, you know? And they all went back to save Han Solo. And there's not really a super huge acknowledgement of that's like saving, but that there is an acknowledgement of the fact that they're like hugging and the gang's all here, you know? And that's really nice. It's just nice to feel like that as an audience and to like root for your trio, you know, the characters that you've been introduced to. And like I say trio, but like I also feel the same way about Lando too. I love them. And I love the fact that Return of the Jedi doesn't shy away from that.
Yeah, I totally agree.
And then the second thing that I didn't mention before is how much I love the scene when Leia meets Wicket, the Ewok. You know, she crashes and Wicket is there. And the way that she interacts with Wicket is so different from what you might expect. And I think that it doesn't get talked about enough about how Leia is like not afraid of this creature with a spear, you know, and the fact that she's immediately holding hands with Wicket. And I think that's so cute. It is so cute. And it really goes with the dare to be cute aspect that George instilled in Return of the Jedi. But it also makes Leia such an amazing hero in the fact that she is like, oh, you're scared of my hat? Like, it's a hat. Are you hungry? Because, you know,
snack.
And I think, yeah. And I think that, you know, are you hungry? Have a snack is so like, why are you angry?
You're not hungry.
You're hungry. Yes, it's very Snickers, but it's also very, I don't know, a little unexpected, I guess. And it's just perfect. And then on the same vein, I will say that Leia's entire makeover in the Endor Ewok village, and this is my last one, by the way, I used to not like this makeover as a kid because it was like very jarring for me to see Leia not have like a crazy hairdo, but instead have her hair all down. It's just different. You know, it's like, whoa, she has really long hair type of vibe. But now I love it. And I think I need to cosplay this the next time I can because I really love this outfit. And I think it's just such a great dress.
Yeah, I agree. Leia's whole wardrobe has definitely grown on me as I've gotten older. And
it's so weird how that has happened.
It really is. Because I remember sitting in my basement watching during our Star Wars marathons and being like, literally talking about this outfit and saying we didn't like it, didn't like the hair. Which, you know, kind of makes sense, though, because in our day and age, the stick straight hair was super in. And totally. So her hair is very long. I wouldn't say it's frizzy, but it's like very thick, very big. So it kind of makes sense, actually, you know, reflecting why we probably didn't like it back then.
Well, our scope of knowledge of like fashion was like so small. Mm-hmm. So it's sort of like, again, we were young. We hadn't lived a bunch of years. It's just like we didn't know. And I think it's just interesting when you think about it that way. We've talked about this. I keep plugging this, which I just haven't talked about in a long time, but our Essays on Carrie episodes, we really talked through our sort of personal renaissance with the character of Leia and how we've always loved the character, but she wasn't our number one for a long time. And I think that for both of us, like, she means so much to us now that it's weird to look back on scenes like this one on Endor and be like, oh, I remember when I didn't like this outfit, because like, how could I not like something that Leia Organa did? Mm. That's so crazy. It's just wild. I don't know. Return of the Jedi is just so special, and it is
so great.
It really is. Like, you know, I say that I've said that Empire Strikes Back is like my favorite original trilogy, but it's really not, because Return of the Jedi is the one that makes me feel the most.
Ooh, yeah. This is breaking news, guys.
Okay, here's the thing. I think Empire Strikes Back is like still like a better movie, like if I were to put it up for something, okay? But I think that Return of the Jedi makes me feel the most.
Are you switching your fave for the original trilogy?
I don't really have a fave, okay? I don't believe in the ranking, and neither do you.
No, it's not a ranking. It's what's your favorite from each trilogy?
I think
because you're right. We don't like to do rankings.
I think right now it's Return of the Jedi. Yeah, Caitlin and I, if we are not clear about this, we are so anti-ranking. Like, I can't even handle it. I just can't, even though like there are clear favorites in the in the trilogies, but that doesn't mean like I'm interested in ranking. So to your question, I think Return of the Jedi is my latest fave.
Yay. Wow. Welcome to my side of things.
Yeah. I recently asked my parents both this question. They both said Return of the Jedi too.
They have taste.
I know.
There are no wrong answers, though. So
it's so true. There are no wrong answers. If someone's like, "Oh, my favorite is A New Hope because blah blah blah," I'm like, "That's true. Maybe my favorite is A New Hope too." Like
A New Hope was my favorite for a long time, actually, from the original trilogy. So yeah, no wrong answers.
I can be swayed so easily. But this year at this time,
oh okay,
it's Return of the Jedi. And honestly, it's probably been Return of the Jedi for the past like 2 years.
Yeah. Yeah.
So,
well, is there anything else we want to say about Return of the Jedi in this episode?
Not particularly. I mean, I'm so glad that we took the time to talk through it. I was dying to talk about the Leia, Bush, Vader, Luke connection. I was dying to. So this is like, honestly, the purpose of this episode was like, I think we need to list all of the things we love about Return of the Jedi and put it out there because it is such a special movie. And I want to say that, you know, Blast Points has our friends at Blast Points, Jason and Gabe, they have created a lot of content around Return of the Jedi. Mm-hmm. And they have talked about how there is like a specific type of person who like grew up with Return of the Jedi, and how if Caitlin and I talk a lot about like directors and like director headcanons, and these are people that we do not know, right? Like, we don't know these people.
Yeah.
But at the same time, like, we can infer some things about how they grew up and based off of like what Star Wars movie they saw. And I've always thought, they have commented on this before, that it's interesting that Rian Johnson is a Return of the Jedi kid, that Dave Filoni is a Return of the Jedi kid, and JJ is a New Hope kid. And I think that the A New Hope situation is really reflected in The Force Awakens. His love for that movie is like, The Force Awakens is a love letter to A New Hope. In a lot of ways, I think that's like partly due to The Force Awakens' success, right? Mm-hmm. But I think it says something about some of the creators that we have followed who have made Star Wars, about like what their first Star Wars movie is. And I don't even know what I would, at this point, like, I don't even know what I would say to mine. I think probably the first like substantial Star Wars movie that I was like really into was Revenge of the Sith, and that's like my story. But I saw other Star Wars movies before that. But so it's like, it's not like a linear process is the point. But I do think it's interesting, and something that Blast Points has commented on is like, if you're a Return of the Jedi person, you really do check like a couple of different boxes about like, you love the redemption story, you love the weird stuff in Jabba the Hutt's palace, right? And I think that that's so interesting. Yeah. And sometimes that comes up later, and you can align like some of your Star Wars interests and your interest in like the weird stuff, like, it can kind of come back to Return of the Jedi. And I think that's part of what makes it a really special movie.
Well, I think especially because, you know, just the time frame of when the original trilogy came out versus us watching the prequels or even Revenge of the Sith being like your like first movie in a lot of ways, or like first fandom movie, I guess we could say, because it's not like they were able to rewatch all of the movies all the time in the same way that we are now, you know? So it's like, if Return of the Jedi was out the summer you were eight, that's what you were seeing in the movie theater every single weekend, you know?
Exactly. And not just like that year. It's like it was in the theaters for like 3 years. So like that's how it was.
Yeah.
Also, it's interesting because I say that and your first Star Wars movie was The Phantom Menace. And it's not like you're like a huge Phantom Menace fan. I'm not trying to speak for you, but like, I don't think that movie necessarily defines your Star Wars fandom.
No,
but at the same time, the prequels do, I think.
Yeah. Well, you know, I think I'm an interesting case just of having seen all of them kind of in a row, because the one I felt the most connected to the first time we watched through was A New Hope. But then I also don't know if that's because you were like, oh, I like Hayden Christensen. And I was like, oh, okay, I'll like Mark Hamill. And so it's like, okay, but these are then, this is like my half.
you know,
I feel like as
I feel bad about that, I think, looking back.
I mean,
but I just think it's just the way it was.
It's just the way it was. You know, as teenage girls, you got to divide and conquer. And like, if you had Hayden, I had Mark. And like, that's just the way it was. True. I wasn't going to have the guy with the beard. That just wasn't me at 13 years old. Okay. You know, it's just kind of the way it was. But despite all of that, I do know that Luke in A New Hope was like that kind of, oh, okay, I get this kind of moment for me in a big way. So yeah, I think that's a really interesting comment and a good way to kind of round out the show.
Totally.
Well, I do think that's going to wrap up this episode on 40 things we loved about Return of the Jedi for its 40th anniversary. I also think we plugged a lot of our past episodes in this show, more so than we've done in recent memory. So definitely go back and listen to those and tell us what you think. Tell us if we're talking about the same things we talked about back then so we can know how repetitious we're being. Actually, please don't tell us how repetitious we're being.
Yeah, I don't want to hear that.
But please go listen to our crawl episode. Give it some love. Actually, if I had to pick out of all the episodes we've kind of plugged, I would say please go listen to our Essays on Carrie episodes because those are probably some of our favorites that we've done in the past year or so. And they're, like Charlotte said, they're very kind of important to our reflection on who we were at 13 watching these movies, honestly, in our relationship.
And who we are now.
Yeah, exactly.
I think that has totally changed.
Yeah, exactly. So definitely go and give those a listen. We are hoping to do more from that book this year. So be on the lookout for that. But anyway, thank you guys so much for listening. Please tell us if you were able to go and see Return of the Jedi in theaters. And if, like us, it was your first time seeing it in theaters, or if you are lucky enough to see it when it actually came out in theaters, and kind of how the experience has changed now and then for you. We would love to hear about it. You can find us on Twitter at SkytalkersPod or our personal handles. Charlotte's is at Clarity and mine is at Caitlin Plusher. We also have our website, skytalkers.com, our Instagram, TikTok, Facebook, all good places to find us. We would love it if you would take a screenshot of you listening to the show right now and share it on your social media platform of choice. Tag us and we will share it. It's a great way, kind of like word of mouth, to tell other people that you're listening to the show and invite them to listen as well. And it like makes our day when you do it. We get really excited to see those come in. And if you have time and you'd like to leave us an actual written review on Apple Podcasts or a rating on Spotify, we would be so appreciative if you took a couple seconds to go and do that. And lastly, if you are looking for more ways to support Skytalkers, you can head on over to our Patreon and check out our different reward tiers there.
And I want to say a huge thank you to these patrons: Matza, Angela, Bailey, Brad, Charlotte, Chris, Daniel, Danny, David, Derek, Diana, Dylan, Emma, Fernanda, Fifi, Froppy, Jacqueline, James, Joey, John, Catherine, Katie, Kelly, Lauren, Marty, Olivia, Poncho's mom, Rachel, Sam, Sarah, and Shelby. Thank you so much for supporting us.
Yes, thank you guys so much. And until next time, may the Force be with you.
May the Force be with you.